Hi, this is Karen McKee, retired scientist and author. As most of you know, a typical scientific paper follows a formal structure with five main sections: introduction, methods, results, discussion, and conclusions, plus abstract and references. Each section presents different aspects of the research being reported, but some sections are more difficult to write than others. In previous videos, I've provided some guidelines to writing the introduction and the discussion, which are two sections some people have trouble writing. In this video, I'm going to focus on the conclusion section, which can also pose some challenges to the scientific writer. First, let's talk about what is expected in the conclusion section. Some people make the mistake of simply summarizing the points made in the discussion. Now, there's nothing wrong with a summary, but if your target journal requires a conclusion section, then you need to take your main research finding and put it into a broader perspective. What do I mean by this? Instead of just summarizing your results, explain to the reader why your results are important and how they contribute to the field. Here I've made a list of points you might address in a conclusion section. First, always put your study's topic into a broader context to show the reader why they should care about your results. You also want to remind your reader of your main finding by briefly summarizing it, and then interpret that finding in relation to the broader issue. You can also point out the limitations of your study or alternative interpretations in the conclusions, which will help the reader put your study into perspective. You can also describe implications of your findings for other types of systems. Describe any practical applications of your results, if any. Finally, you may wish to suggest areas for future research. You don't need to address all of these in every paper or in this exact order. They are just suggestions to aid in writing your conclusions. Let's now look at an example. In this recent paper, still in press, I started the conclusion section by saying that sea level rise, driven by global warming, threatens coastal wetlands worldwide with submergence. Understanding how hurricanes may interact with processes controlling coastal elevations will aid in management of these ecosystems and the services they provide. These two sentences frame the broader issues that the study relates to and lead the reader into our study's topic: hurricanes and sediment accretion in a subtropical wetland. In the following sentences, I continue to put the work into a larger perspective by pointing out how mangroves have been expanding globally and what this might mean for vulnerability of coastal wetlands to rising sea level. I then summarized our main finding that mangrove and salt marsh vegetation captured similar amounts of hurricane sediment. The interpretation is next that climate-induced shifts in dominant vegetation in this particular setting may not alter hurricane sediment capture. The next several sentences point out the limitations of our study. For example, we don't know how long the hurricane sediment might persist or if differences might occur later because of differences between mangrove and salt marsh habitats. The conclusion section ended with suggestions for future research. Well, that was a fairly long conclusion section. Here's another example that's shorter and uses fewer points in a slightly different order. In this study, which was part of my dissertation research, I tested the hypothesis that crab predation on mangrove propagules determines spatial variation in tree dominance across a forest. Here is the conclusion section, which you can see is quite brief, but it still includes some of the key points I've already covered. Let's break it down. I started by summarizing the main finding that although predation affected propagule viability, the patterns of consumption were only partially consistent with tree dominance. I then spelled out what this meant, which was that predation could not by itself explain how mangrove species were distributed in the forest and that other factors were likely involved. Such a take-home message is what you want to include in your conclusions. The second paragraph puts the work into a global perspective by summarizing findings from different geographic regions. The section ends with a recommendation that other factors need to be considered in future studies of mangrove zonation. Those are just a couple of examples to illustrate how to write a conclusion section using this list of possible points to cover. If you're still uncertain about what to include in your conclusions, your target journal is a good place to begin. Analyze a few recent papers in that journal and see what points the authors cover in their conclusions. Then use that information to outline your conclusion section. Once you see how it's done, you'll be able to develop your own formula for writing a compelling and informative conclusion section. Thanks for watching, and please like my video if you found it helpful.